For our final presenter, do you have the...
Yeah, I've got the microphone.
But you're kind of a special case, because we have to punish you. Because he's a really advanced Vim user, or at least he told me during his job interview that he was a really advanced Vim user. That generates a macro file and like a settings file, and then as a good programmer, he once in a while commits all his configuration to GitHub in a public repository, also really cool. But then if there's in that RC file some secure keys from our S3 account, our Amazon account, we get emails, and we're pretty close to Werner Vogel, so yeah, he was not that angry, but he said, well, please remove that, because otherwise other people start mining bitcoins on your account, and yeah, it's tied to maybe to Timo's credit card, I'm not sure, but yeah. So we have to find a punishment for you. But let's sing a song, or what shall we do?
No, please don't.
Do the dishes.
Do the dishes?
Yeah, that's really good.
Oh, did someone already
do the dishes?
No, we don't need to do the dishes. We're not even allowed to.
But then if he doesn't make it, what should we do?
I can always buy some rotten tomatoes and then we can have a nice, how do you call it, cachot? Yeah. Session.
Okay.
The ice bucket challenge.
Yeah, but he has to be nominated.
We all know.
Okay, well, say sorry to all of them.
That's really hard for me, but yeah. Okay, well, sorry. So it will not happen again.
But it's actually a nice follow-up on the story of Blendl, because you work on a system that supplies them with like the PDFs and the images.
Yeah, there's also some comes from the content library where we're working on. So it's,
we ran into a lot of the problems that you're mentioning with the related items. Mm. The poor language support for Elasticsearch, so that's why we're using Solr. That kept us from moving to Elasticsearch in the beginning. So.
But they've been better now. I've tested it, and they have quite a reasonable support for languages. Yeah. I thought so.
Okay. But this is about watermarking images. So
yes.
Take it away.
Okay. Well, I'm Edgar Clerks. I'm working at the content library. We were working at a track in the images, which people use and people are reusing these images. And we actually wanted to count which images are reused by who and etc. So we were thinking, how would we do this? So, well, one of the ways we had was, for example, XMP or EXIF or whatever. So we had a whole couple of possibilities. And this also came up, invisible watermarking. What you actually do is you embed in the image data itself, so in the color channels, you embed some invisible pattern, or almost invisible, and you then read it back and you look at it. Well, and actually, there are a couple of possibilities of image tracking at this moment. I see. Okay. Oh, well, this is what I'm going to talk about, but I don't care about it too much. So why would you do that? Well, one of the things you want to do is marking of your property. So, for example, for ANP wants to know what his image is, because it can be come from several sources. The photographer can leak it, or they can do it themselves, or they lend it to Sanoma, and then it is property of Sanoma officially. So et cetera. There's information you can embed in the image. You can identify a leak, because we at Playboy, images get leaked to Geen Stijl, for example. Well, there's something we don't want. So what you can then do is send your employees all a tagged image with a specific pattern in it, and then see which one pops up in the media, and then just scan the image back and detect the pattern. It's quite possible to do this. identification of the origin. So you want to know, okay, this is from nu.nl, this is from Libelle, this is from etc. So from which magazine it comes. Yeah, maybe also identifying the image itself, because this is the one that needs the most information, because we have a lot of images. We have, I think, more than a million. So we take now 12 bytes, that's just the Munkle ID. And we have to encode the Munkle ID in the image then to make that possible. So, well, there's some use cases I think are nice
to have.
It's down. Okay, well, what kind of properties do these watermarks have? At least what would I like to have them? Well, they should be resistant to image transformations. You can see if you crop, for example, and your watermark is localized to a certain part of the image, well, you just crop it out and then your information is gone. So that's not good. Like cutting, resizing, rotating, color changes, etc., and all kinds of other stuff. It should be invisible to the user, so it should not be seeable. It should be detectable, and especially photographers are very sensitive to it, because if you add information in some hidden way, you always touch in the image in certain ways. For example, the contrast can change. We can see that in a live demo, how things will change, or you cause artifacts, you can see, etc. So it should not be detectable, almost not, or at least for the human eye, it should be indetectable. And there are some models of that, but it's very complex. I haven't gone that far at this moment, but I've already had some information about it, how to do that. And if you change to another image, so say we have a PNG and we pull it to a JPEG, then it goes to some transformations, like a wavelet transform, and this just pulls out some images, and all the versions does a discrete cosine transform, and then they wipe the higher frequencies, because they're quite empty of information for a compression. Well, you should also, it should survive that, I think. Well, there are actually some software on the market at this moment, which it was more or less this, but it's not very happy. Well, the easiest one is of course metadata. You just add a header to the image file, XMP, EXIF. But it's quite easy to remove if you load it in, I don't know, GIMP, and then you export it, it's gone. So that's not very good. It's a reasonable protection, because most people will not change the image a lot, I think. You can put in the file name, but yeah, only dumb people will steal your images like that. But people do. You see it in servers, that people just take the image and just keep the name, and there's just Sanoma in it or whatever. Put it on the server, I don't know. And you can do least significant bit coding. So you take off the color channel, you take the colors, and you take the least significant bits. You reset them all to zero, and then you can fight down your information in there. That actually works quite well, but it is not very resistant to transformation, especially for color transformation. So if you putting up the contrast or equalizing the histograms or whatever, it's gone. So that's not very good. Okay, well, so I tried a couple of things. This Caesar transformations. This was one of the which didn't work very well, but the idea is very simple. You pretend that the image is on a cylinder, and this you actually winding it up just like Caesar encoding does. Okay, and then you rotate it a bit, and then you fire down your image. Well, it didn't work very well, because if you move it around and you move it back, and somebody cut the image, the information is gone, because the cylinder has this white, and the white has always be the same. So I've difficult a demo for this, because I wiped my computer last week accidentally. But I have a demo for the other stuff, so don't worry too much. It was a neat idea, because if you have some more interesting scheme to move things around, because if you can see here, most of the rows are still close together. But you can really spread out an image, and then if you move it back, you get your information back. Okay, well, the next one I tried is Fourier transforms. The thing you do is you take the image and you transform it to Fourier space. And what you actually do then is you make a frequency. You count the frequencies. You see the image as a wave. So let's pretend it's the image, only one dimensional. That's this black thing here. You don't see it very much, but it's a block wave. You are going to analyze it, and what you actually are going to do is to approximate it with waves. So as you can see here, if I take one wave, it is not very accurate, but if I take more and more and more, up to 11, then it's get very accurate and you have almost your block wave back. Now what you do then is you take those frequencies and you put them into your image and then you write down their information, because the frequency space is quite empty. There's also another space, that's the phase space. That's where the waves are delayed a bit, because sometimes the block wave, it's nicely standing here, but if someone moved here, then you get a different phase, so you have to move it a little bit. Okay, well, this one, but oh, I already talked about it. So this is what you do, you transform the signal. Now that's the discrete wave transform. Does anybody know Fourier transformations? Ah, yeah. Yeah, I was a bit in the dubio to talk a lot about it, but it is, did anybody catch the concept that you can approximate an image with a wave? Or did anybody not do that? Okay, well, that's good. So what you do is you stamp your mark in the frequency information, then you transform it back. And this has some nice properties, because it is a wave, it is not delimited to one place in the image. It's actually everywhere, so it is a wave. It moves over the whole image. So what you do if you hit, if you put a mark in that frequency domain, you're actually generating waves in normal space. So it's nicely cropped out. So if you crop out a small part, you still have the information left. It's reasonably resistant to image transformation. You can rotate it and you can detect that, because yeah, there's always some kind of, how do you call it? Yeah. You should actually look at it, but you always see some kind of line in the Fourier transformation. Yeah, color changes doesn't change it too much. So, well, and I can actually show this. In the front image, I always hit an image in there. Maybe you didn't see it, but it's just in Biba I put in there. We can actually get it back too, so well, let's get to that a little bit. No, you don't see Biba because of the load shit. That is a bit of the problem, yeah? Okay. Actually. No. Yeah, but I cannot see things too. No. Okay, this is very unfortunate because I'm half blind, so yeah. I have to wrap it back, I'm sorry. yeah, let's so point one. Nou, dat is niet goed. Oké, wel, het is just a small script. Het is nou winnen. It takes some time because it's a very big image and it's not very fast. I actually put now a QR code in. Oh, wait. Oh, this is too small. No. I'm sorry. I have to take another image. yeah, okay, well, let's use the Biba then. Okay, well, now. Okay, well, here you see the embedding process. This is the phase space I talked about. It's more about the positioning where the wave starts, or more or less. It's not exactly the same. And as you can see, that space is almost empty. There's nothing in there. Just a little bit on the ends. That are the frequencies which make up the image. That are the white spicules. And we're just putting it there because it's almost empty. And it's a good place to put it in. If you put it in here, then the image gets completely distorted. I can show that too, but it's quite interesting. Okay, well, now you'll see three channels because I will put it in all of them. Pop. Okay, well, here's the image. Here's the image back. Well, there's another difference, this image back. There's the difference in the image itself, so this difference it generates. You see it's mostly gray. Oh, another difference. Okay, we also have some. My favorite.
No, go back.
Yeah.
Dit moet ik testen. Oh joh.
We're not going to do it today. Okay, well, this is the marked image now. I put a QR code in it, and I will also show the... No, just to test on it. I also try to embed it in an elephant penis, and all went well. So, it's all kind of...
I think it's a good punishment that for your test environment of the content library, you only get Justin Bieber.
Yeah. So, this is the real image. I hope I can switch it. Oh, God damn it. Am I good now? See, there's a very little difference. I got the photograph for here. He's sitting there. Can you see a difference? No, he cannot today. So, last time I tried it, he found all kinds of differences. But there's a problem. It is not. The problem is that the Fourier analysis, for some reason, and I don't know why, I try to find out why, but it's quite a computation you have to make by hand. it takes the mark you have and then it rotates it left 180 degrees and then boom, it puts it again there. So you get some kind of strange mirrored image. I can show you now. One of the problems is so that's not a very nice way to. Work with this. Oh. Yeah?
Can I ask a quick question?
Yes?
Is the intention that we watermark all things in the
Yes. that would be nice. but it will be very fast. Okay, now we have this. This. Okay, this is actually a mark I extracted from it. Well, I can assure you a QR code reader cannot read this, and it's because something in the space rotates it. There's some kind of symmetry. It's, I don't know. It's a strange thing. So Fourier analysis only works if you have a rotational symmetrical pattern to embed in here. So I went to wavelet transforms. It's a generalization of Fourier transforms. It's actually where a Fourier transform is infinite long, and etc. A wavelet is just localized also in time, so or in space in this case, as we call it. But so this is a smaller thing to work with. But, where's my presentation now? I think it's here. Oh, I killed the presentation. I'm sorry. it is back. Okay. Nice. Things happen. Okay, well, yeah, it has to be symmetric in a 180 degree left rotation. That's very annoying, and the information is spread everywhere, which is a good thing, but it's also a bad thing. I will show in the end of the presentation what happens if you amplitude the mark, if the mark is bigger than, say, 20% of the image. You get all kinds of strange things. So I was searching for a more localized thing, which was, yeah, it's somewhat bad. On the other hand, it's more manageable in its effects. So that are wavelet transforms, and here you see some of the transforms. As you can see, they're not infinite. They have a defined length, and the transform works. You just twice one of those, Actually, just like a free transform, it tries to approximate all the objects in the image with those transforms, and then get the frequencies out of the L, actually the scaling factor, because he makes them bigger or longer, etc. And then he generates a couple of images out of that. Well, they have a more local character, and they survive most transformation except cutting out the middle in this case, because we always will fight it down in the middle. But I don't think that happens a lot, because mostly people faces are there or some crucial information is there. And it's also very strange to look at a picture with just some kind of thing cut out. So I think that would be a good place. I think that's an exception, that you have to do it on the side. So. You can make an exception out of that. Okay, and this one is actually pretty spectacular because it's almost not visible. Where's my mouse? Oh, there's my mouse. Okay. And it almost gives back a perfect image, so I was quite happy about this one. I shall not choose the elephant penis.
But
yeah, I don't know. I was. Yeah, but that's what you think if you look at Justin Bieber, then you think elephant penis somehow. At least that's how my brain works. Just the way it is, you know. Oh, and I also have a newspaper with a guy. Oh, no, never mind. We can do that one. I think that's good. Actually a different thing. Here we have again, this is the upper level region of the higher frequencies of the wavelet transform. So the wavelet transform is really compressed into a very small one. Then I just fight it down there. You see some information in it, but it's almost empty. If you throw this away, you have the same image, you don't see it at all. So it's very strange, but it's just empty this shit. I don't know why. Even kijken. Oh, he's now doing. Ah, yeah. Okay, well, this extract that maken is just the perfect thing again. So it's very nice. We can read this with the phone without the colors. I forgot to set the color map. You have to use pyplot, and if you don't set the color map, you come with out ratios, default colors. I don't know why he does that. What's standing there? I don't know. Oh, this is the difference. Yeah, the difference doesn't. This is the difference in the image itself. Dit is in een logarithm, of een logarithm, so it's actually very small differences, but I had to amplify them to make them visible. I think that's nicer. And you see, it actually is not very localized, because in the back something happens too. It can also be of the approximation of the wavelet, because I only did 4 iterations, so it's not a very precise thing I take out. No, this is just a difference in the gray map.
Yeah, but darker the pixel.
No, the whiter. So this is the modified part, actually. So this is some gray goo. Okay, well, now we can look at those images. I found this. Oh, no. Okay, I have to. I don't know, I haven't found out how to mirror my computer yet. It's really annoying, but I get used to it. Okay, well, this is my extracted mark.
Oh, it's not coming. It's here somewhere. Ah, yeah. Okay, that's just your QR code, and you can even read it. So. And oh yeah, well, maybe the image is better even.
And this is the marked image. Yeah, this is the marked image. I did it in grayscale in this case. So it's a bit bit difficult to. Oh, this is also a very bad image. Okay, never mind. It's not very good. Okay, different grayscale, so it is a bit, it's actually not comparable with the real image, so that's a bit annoying.
And this is the, if you see it, la la la.
It's a bit of a shame, I did not put, there's a color image, so I should have put it everywhere. But yeah, it is not, but you don't see this, there's a watermark in it, I think. Still, it's still
not seeable. Okay, well.
Yeah, well, there was that somewhat. Well, let's go back here. Okay, well, I have some questions, or do you want to see something, or I don't know.
Yeah. Yes.
The image. Can the like the hypothetical image field to do the same? So transform first to the frequency domain and then see the locator is kind of mark and then zero out those or make them like the environment and then basically you're done with the
now it's quite visible, I think. So you see it sitting there. Now, for example, for the wavelets, you can just make more iterations because then it's some kind of a hide and seek game. For the Fourier transform, I think you can spread out the information more because the QR code is quite compact and you can move it over a much bigger space. So it has itself some noisy quality. Or you can try, I haven't tried that, because you can try to Fourier transform the Fourier transform and then embed it and then put it back. I don't know, I think you can find out some ways to...
Can you remove
them? Yeah, if you remove them, but if you remove them, you also remove part of the image information. So that's a kind of tricky thing to do.
Say, watermark image.
Yes. Yes.
Then you would lose a big part of your information, I guess.
Yes. Yeah, if you just write down a shitload of information in that frequency space, you're losing, you're actually adding frequencies, so that will have some consequences in the real world at a certain moment. And in the beginning it's very small because most of the frequencies is empty, so what you actually do is just not, you don't write a value of 1, you write actually a value of 0.1 because you're looking at it in a logarithm, with a logarithm at it. So it's also 10 times more than the environment, for example. But if you make really just opaque letters in it, then it will. It actually gives quite nice images because you're generating waves, so you get a very trippy image, but it's not useful anymore. It's not recognizable anymore. But it's quite nice to generate images that way. It's
If I understand it correctly, the watermark is kind of stored in the center of the image?
Yeah, you can move it everywhere, but I'm quite lazy, so I just... Yeah.
We have a kind of situation we call the Bert and Ernie image.
Yeah.
Whereas Bert is on the left and Ernie on the right, and you crop Bert, and that will be your image for a certain news article. If I understand it correctly, you chop your watermark in that case.
Yeah, well, in the case that the Fourier transform performs well, you should use that because then it doesn't matter where you crop. But the Fourier transform, it gives restrictions in what you add into that space. So that's a bit of a problem. You should give a pattern which withstands that. So that rotation thing, if you have that, then you don't have a problem because it's everywhere in the image. And with the wavelet, I think you have to locate the points of interest, but it's probably quite difficult because there's a lot of other stuff going on there.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Sell to us, but we just jump in.
But
we're interested in, and
Yeah, but actually that's the same problem with the original or with the traditional watermark is that you is the watermark is always here, so the bit of irony will still get cut off. So I think somebody should just in the worst case, Mechanical Turk should say, okay, that's a good one. Something like that, or you should.
Final question.
No.
Yeah.
Ah, yeah.
So if you recognize the watermark by some hacky way,
yeah,
you can also reverse engineer the original
image. Yes, yes. That's the nicest case, but I found out the smaller the image gets, the less information you get in there. And sometimes you don't get even 12 bytes in there, or 10 bytes. So you don't. You don't always have the option to put a whole ID in there from something. Or so that's a problem. I think you have need some kind of site mechanism to get enough information out of the image itself, plus the information which you embedded to get to that point. But
probably easier to just buy the image.
it's a good technology.
Yeah. Yeah. Yeah.
Okay, well, cool.
Thanks a lot.
Yes.
And then you now know what the next punishment will be if you leave the S3 KR code with that car.
Oh, no. Okay, well.
Okay, thank you all for coming. There was a slide with some additional dates, but. On October 6th, there's the next sake. It will be held in Helsinki again. I hope you all come if your manager approves. No, Jelmer, you can't go. Oh, there, you have to go.
Do we have a kitchen there?
Timo, do we have a kitchen there? Because the cook wants to come.
Where was it?
The next one in the Netherlands is in December.